Every once in a while, I stumble upon a quote, a video, or maybe a song, and boy, does it knock me off my feet. It just moves me to my core. And today's guest did just that in about 2 seconds. His name is Wintley Phipps. He's a singer. He's a songwriter. He's a minister. And if you're one of the 25 million people who watched his various renditions of Amazing Grace on YouTube, you know exactly who I'm talking about. Wintley's voice is gorgeous, and he spent a lifetime using it to elevate the lives of others. Wintley has performed before 7 U.S. presidents, but his voice is just one of the gifts he shares with those around him. He also shares his time. He makes space in his life to lift up kids he feels need it the most, which is why Wintley founded the U.S. Dream Academy, a program mentoring children of incarcerated parents. As you listen to Wintley share his wisdom, I'd love for you and me to ask ourselves the same question. Am I giving life the best version of myself? As you can imagine, I am bursting to talk with him. Wisdom, purpose, guidance, right here, right now. Wintley Phipps, my word. Wintley, the first time I heard your voice, I heard you sing Amazing Grace, and it's like someone was holding my heart in their hands. I couldn't believe what I was listening to. Tell me what's going through you when you're singing those words.
Well, I found out the melody of that song sounds very much like a West African sorrow chant. And all Negro spirituals, just about all Negro spirituals, were written on what we call it the black notes of the piano or the pentatonic scale. And it just so happens that this song, Amazing Grace, the most famous religious Christian hymn in history, the melody was written on that same scale that the slaves used. Mm. And it sounds like it just sounds, it's got so much power and pathos in it.
Can I just say one thing? You hummed a few bars, and I'm not kidding, head to toe and back down again. Chills all over.
Oh, yes. Well, it's just, and people often ask, why does that melody touch us the way it does? And I think it's because it still speaks to the slave in us, because we're all struggling. We're all dealing with. There's something that's threatening to hold us back, hold us down, to shackle us. And that melody represents hope. Mm. It represents solace. Mm. It represents encouragement. And so when I hum it, I hear and feel the sounds of slave ships.
Well, you know what's amazing about you, and I've heard you speak a little Wintley here and there, and I've always blown away. And you sometimes talk about your childhood, and you'll say it had some troubles. Did you find God when you were that little, or
no? For me, all I had were my dreams, and my dreams were my first connection to God. Mm. In other words, in the quiet crucible of your personal private sufferings, your noblest dreams are born, and God's greatest gifts are given. And often God gives his greatest gifts in compensation for what you've been through. Well, that's what happened to me. I wanted to be another Sly Stone.
Because you had those pipes.
Yeah, I wanted to do thank you for letting me be myself, you know what I mean? But I met Sly when I was 16, and he was stoned. And
I said, no. He was stoned?
Yeah, he was stoned. Something's wrong with this picture. My hero is incoherent, you know. But the long and short of it is, when I was 16, I met my musical heroes. I met these heroes of mine early. Hoda, I saw they had money, they had fame. They had everything but they weren't happy.
What was missing?
Well, I asked, for example, I asked one of the vice presidents of Motown Records one day. I said, how many of the principal artists at Motown have had long, happy marriages and families? Mm. And he thought, he said, really none of them.
None, yeah.
And being a child who did not have a family when I was growing up, I didn't want to miss out on that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and by the way, that's one thing that will help you be straight, because you don't want to mess. You want what you didn't have as a child, and you don't want to mess that up. So here I was pushing away my Sly Stone dream and pushing away my Tom Jones dream. But I had this voice.
Mm.
And I was coming to age at a time when the music industry, get this, Hoda, was removing male bass baritone solos off of the music scene. Whether it's a Paul Robeson,
yeah,
or whether it's a Arthur Prysock or Joe Williams, or you'll never find, you know, Lou Rawls singing down there, or Barry White.
Uh-huh.
There are no bass baritone hip-hop modern popular singers today, right?
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, I found myself alone. But it's okay, because alone is another synonym for unique. So when I get up to sing, you know, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. When I'm singing, people often are listening to a voice and a sound coming out of the body of a human being they have never heard live, or never heard from somebody else. And so I give a lot of hope to a lot of men who sound like me, who don't know what can we do with this anymore.
You know? Oh, you give a lot of hope to a lot of people. I interviewed Dolly Parton a while ago, and she said, when I was younger, Hoda, I just sang in East Tennessee in the mountains. We didn't know the right way, this way, like that one. We just sang. So when she came to Nashville, she went to a recording studio, and she sang like only Dolly sang, because it came from inside. And she's such an original. And I was just thinking about how that makes her unique and who God probably intended her to be. And I look at you, and I see a guy who is that. I mean, you know, I just feel that that's that individual piece of you is on display. How did you maintain that kind of compass to be true to you?
Well, first of all, that little voice, which I now know is God, gave me a little quote. Again, it's not one of those little quotes that are attributable to his impressing my heart with these words: you don't have to compromise to be recognized.
Uh-huh.
In other words, be faithful to who you are, who you were called to be. Any door that needs to be opened for you will open.
When did you get called to God? Like, when did that, and how did that come to be?
I attended actually a Christian school for my last year of high school. And I remember it was a shock for me, because I had come from my Sly Stone dreams in the streets and the hood. And here I was in this very strict environment. You know, they were turning the lights out in the dorm at 10 o'clock at night. But of course, this is 1971. And they had rules like you couldn't hold hands with the girls on campus, you know, that kind of stuff. So I went to the dean of men. I said, hey, I'm leaving. I can't take all these rules and regulations. And then he said to me, is that what you really want to do? I said, yeah. And then he said, why don't you do for once, not what you want to do, but what God wants you to do?
Oh, wow.
And that thing hit me. And I went up to my room. Oh, that was the first time I ever prayed in my life. And I got on my knees and I said, okay, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do. I said, if you want me to be a garbage man for you, I'll be a garbage man. If the only music I'll ever know is whistling hymns on the back of a garbage truck, that's fine. And then I said, you know, I'd love to travel and use my talents for you. And if that's your will for me, open the doors. Let me see in some way. And a day went by. A couple men came up to me and said, are you Wintley Phipps? I said, yeah. I said, listen, we've been hearing about you. We want you to travel and do singing evangelism with us. Now, when you pray and then see a prayer answered for the first time in your life, it scars you for life. It scars you. And so I walked that campus in a daze for a couple of days because I think, so there is a God.
Yeah. Wow.
You know, and then I started listening and Hoda, I heard that it was the first time I felt the impression of that voice that I've told you about. And I heard the voice say to me, I've seen your dreams. Mm. Give me your dreams and I'll let you glimpse a little of what I've been dreaming for you.
Mm.
If you can just be faithful to the best of your ability, I'm going to take your life down an unusual path. You will sing to the masses. And you will speak truth to people of influence and power. And that has been my life.
Do you ever or have you ever lost your way?
Well, I would say life is about losing your way a lot. In other words, whenever I make a choice or a decision that I know is not in harmony with my values and is not in harmony with that voice that's telling me, don't do that, I lose my way.
Mm-hmm.
We lose our way. But thank God we can course correct quickly, sometimes on our knees, sometimes in tears. Just calling out, frankly, I have been in the most abject of places calling out to God.
Mm.
Some do it at their kitchen tables, some at their beds. It doesn't matter to me where I am. That prayer, God, give me your grace, give me your wisdom, show me the way forward. And I often hear that voice saying to me, I'll take care of you.
Mm.
I'll take care of you. And for me, that is the most comforting, encouraging thing. So that's probably a strange way of answering your question about losing your way. But whenever we are not living in harmony with our values and our dignity and our highest purpose, in that moment, we've really lost our way and we need to course correct.
And for people who feel far from God, because sometimes in life when there's loss and things, you pull back. Do you have any words for those folks?
Well, I will share with them this one powerful truth. I know it to be a truth. You were created to be loved. And you were created to be loved by God. It's up to you whether you let God love you.
Can I just ask you really, just from my soul to yours, you had words for me when I needed them. How does that come to you?
You know, there is a sense and a desire that is overwhelming to be a blessing and to be an encouragement and to be a motivation to help other people during critical times in their lives. And I can't say I was born with it, but I feel this desire to speak into people's lives. And often I speak into people's lives at the most critical moments, the most critical moments of their lives. One of those stories is when I was 41 years ago, I was singing in Baltimore, Maryland. I came down off the platform. I felt a tap on my shoulder. lady said, "Excuse me, sir, I just heard you sing, and I feel like I can talk to you. Do you have time to talk to me?"
Huh.
I said, "Sure." So she came by our home, and we talked and prayed with her. And after praying with her, I looked at her, and I said, "You know, before you go, God has impressed me to tell you he's going to bless you and give you an opportunity to speak to millions of people." She said, "You think God would do that for me?" And it was Oprah Winfrey. And that's how we met all those years ago. And I mean, I can go on and on of experiences like that.
When you said to Oprah, "God compelled me to tell you this," which is, I'm sure, just what she needed to hear at just the right moment, how does God compel you or speak to you, or how did you know that it was something you had to pass along?
You know how you get used to recognizing the voice of a friend?
Mm.
Well, when you're doing your best to walk with God, you begin to recognize the voice of your sweetest friend. Let me tell you an interesting story that really sets the stage for what became my life's work. I was on an Amtrak train from Baltimore to Philadelphia. And on Amtrak, when you don't want somebody sitting next to you, you camp out, put your food
put
and papers around you.
Yeah.
Well, this man had camped out, but there were other seats available. But I walked up to him and I said, "Excuse me, is anybody sitting next to you?"
Mm-hmm.
And he smiled. He said, "No." And he pulled up his food and his papers. That man's name was Chuck Colson, of Watergate fame, Charles Colson, who was one of President Nixon's hatchet men, they called him, who went to prison for the Watergate scandal and made a decision that when he came out of prison, he was going to spend the rest of his life doing one thing, helping prisoners and their families.
Oh, wow.
And we became dear friends. He placed me on his board of directors. And while on the board, Hoda, a very alarming statistic surfaced that about 60 to 70% of all children in America who end up in prison come from the children of those who are in prison now.
Yeah.
It's the children of prisoners who are very much at risk. And also we found that we needed to break that cycle. So we said, "What can we build?" And they said, "Study the problem first." Well, when we studied it, we found out, Hoda, that interactive tutorial academic support is critical to breaking that cycle.
Right.
For example, 60% Hoda, of all black boys in America who don't graduate from high school will be in prison by the age of 30.
Oh, my word.
And so we started the first organization of its kind that we know of called the U.S. Dream Academy. We provide tutoring and mentoring to children of incarcerated parents, children falling behind in school.
This so speaks to your calling, and it strikes me, because if someone's listening to this podcast as they're going about their business, a lot of people have dreams to do something bigger than themselves.
Yes.
They long to, but they get stuck.
Yes.
It's too big. The problem is too massive, or I don't even know where to start to find my purpose. What should I do?
Yes.
I think some practical advice might be good for people who look at you and say, "I want to do that, but I don't even know where to begin." How do you set finding not your job or your occupation, but your purpose?
Well, your purpose, when it is on steroids, is helping people who need you, helping people live their potential in life.
Okay.
And well, you know, and for me, that's what, whether it's Oprah or whether it's a prisoner, it doesn't matter who that person is. One of the first things that you can do is start looking for people you can just speak a word of encouragement to, a word of wisdom to.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is the more you do that, the more you become a force to be reckoned with.
Right, right. And I think a lot of people are going through, whether it's loss of, you know, there's just been a lot of loss in this moment. But whatever someone is struggling with and they don't see any light, they just see darkness. How do you counsel someone who's feeling those kind of feels?
One interesting thing is that light is the only antidote for darkness.
Mm-hmm.
But light comes in many different ways. Most of us are trying to find light by someone giving something to us. But we really find light when we're giving to others. In other words, when you smile to give someone else a smile, it will change your heart. It does something for you. Mm-hmm. It brings light to you. If you're just waiting for somebody to smile at you, you're probably going to stay in darkness, right? But if you're committed and you say, every chance I get, I'm going to try to put a little sunshine in somebody else's life. You can't try to dispel darkness from someone else's life without that light shining on your own life.
And finding your purpose, it doesn't have an age limit, does it? Because I think, you know, some people think, well, I'll just limp along to the end. Here I am. You know, I don't really, you know, some people have retired or they're empty nesters or whatever it is. And they think, well, I think all my best days are behind me, you know, as I move forward.
You've been blessed.
Yeah.
I've been blessed.
Yeah.
I had to find that there's a difference between moments of destiny. And that's what really God taught me. God said, you know, moments of destiny are moments for which you were created. But they're not the reason for which you were created. So you being on NBC, it's an amazing blessing. It's not the reason for which you were created. They represent moments for which you were created, but not the reason for which you were created. The reason for which you were created, your highest purpose, is to grow more every day in kindness, in patience, in love, to become the best version of yourself on earth. You have to switch your focus and almost switch your trajectory. Okay, so I was the first gospel artist on Soul Train, or I did Saturday Night Live. So you want to do it again? You know, it's on your resume. All the stuff that's on your resume.
Yeah.
Is that what you're really, really living for? To get it on your resume again? No. I'm telling you, there's something more beautiful. There's something higher about purpose. And that is to be the best version of yourself.
Lastly, Whitley, could you just leave our listeners with a little something? I think some people see, when they look at the world, they see all the cracks in the painting, you know, and you can't blame anybody. It's just people say, well, that's where we are today. I know you see the world differently. What would be some parting words for our listeners about how to view this world of ours?
The most important thing I can leave with everyone who's listening is this very simple truth. Character is everything. Character is everything. And what I mean by that is, have you noticed in business we hire for skills but fire for character? You know, when there isn't character, it is the most destructive force in the world. We need character in our house. We need character in the White House. We need character in every house. And if somehow we could get that word across, that message across, you can be a person of kindness. You can be a person of patience. You can be a person of self-control. You can be a person of strong faith and belief. I say that that's our, my hope, my dream. How do I do that? I just become a person of character myself and then do my best to introduce that to the world around me. And that's the best thing you could ever do with your life.
I'm not sure if this was just a therapy session for me, but either way, I loved every second of it. Whitley Phipps, wow, you are really extraordinary. I can't thank you enough for spending some time with us and sharing all these pearls of wisdom and light and love and that beautiful voice of yours. Thank you for
you
everything, okay?
You're very welcome. Right. And thank you. Keep doing all that you're doing. We love you. We're proud of you. Oh, keep up the good work.
Thank you, Whitley.
Hey, thanks for watching our YouTube channel. Find your favorite recipes, celebrity interviews, uplifting stories, shop our favorite deals, and so much more with the Today app. Download it now.